Alegre Ramos here, host of Beyond the Sups, and today's guest is Dr. Bryan Haycock, VP of Science and Innovation at B&D Nutritional Ingredients. Good morning, good afternoon. Welcome, Bryan.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here.
So for everyone joining us, a little bit about Bryan. He has a Bachelor's of Science in Psychology, as well as Exercise and Sport Medicine, an MS in Kinesiology, and a PhD in Exercise Physiology. So he was in school for a long time, and he knows a lot about the human body. He's been involved with the dietary supplement industry for over 20 years and the bodybuilding world for over 40, having entered his first bodybuilding competition in 1985. He's also the co-author of a 2016 book called Dietary Supplements, which I'm very excited to read. It sounds like a great foundational book for anyone looking to understand what supplements can and can't do and how to decide what to take. However, he is perhaps most famous for establishing a set of principles around weightlifting for size known as hypertrophic specific training, or HST. Whew, welcome, Bryan.
Thank you.
You've done a lot of different things. It's so fascinating. So if you could tell me a little bit about your health and wellness journey and how you got into the industry.
Okay. Yeah, I believe I had a natural inclination for health, fitness. When I was young, I was just fascinated with the body. I was fascinated with how it worked. And this was before I was interested in looking a certain way. To get dates and those kinds of things. My older sister would have boyfriends that would come around the house, and I would notice, you know, they had veins in their arms and muscles, and they would flex their muscle for me. And I was so impressed. And I thought, you know, boy, when I grow up, I want to have muscles. So
you were eight.
I was
right?
8 years old. Yeah. And my parents bought me my first barbell set and a little bench that went with it. And I still have it to this day.
Oh my gosh.
It's falling apart, but.
Were these kid size, or these were adult size, right?
No, it was small.
Interesting.
It was probably, the bar is probably 4 foot long. Huh. And it just had four weights, two for each side. Maybe the total was maybe 45 pounds. But I was 8 years old. I weighed 75 pounds at the time. And I would take my measurements, and the barbell came with a little weightlifting book. And so I would... devotedly get in there and do my routine and look in the mirror and see if my muscles are growing at all. So I guess today, you know, why kids are playing video games, I was in the basement lifting weights.
Your parents were like, we're not gonna have to worry about this kid.
Nope, as long as he's happy, that's fine.
Interesting.
And when I got a little older, I came onto magazines. We had a friend that worked for a magazine delivery company. Mm. And he knew that I liked bodybuilding. So when he would go around to the different stores, he would collect the previous month's issues that hadn't sold.
Oh, yes.
And in order not to have to ship back all of the magazines, they would just ship back the covers. So he would tear off the covers of the bodybuilding magazines and give them to me. So I have stacks and stacks of old bodybuilding magazines. And I would read those. You know, some kids like comics. I was reading bodybuilding magazines. And they would have various kinds of supplements at that time. And so I'd get on my bike and I would go try this supplement or that. And I didn't really know what they did. I just know here was a big guy and he had muscles and I want to look like that guy. So I'll go buy that product.
And you were just going to like the supermarket to get them?
Yeah. GNC was just starting at this time.
Okay.
Right. When it first came on the scene. So I would go in there and they would sell. What was the first one I remember? Anabolic mega packs, which were just individually packaged amino acid tablets.
Some protein.
Joe Weider, he was selling milk and egg proteins. And then when there were some, you know, they would call them Russian supplements. I guess you'd call them adaptogens today.
Oh, okay.
But they would, you know, they were selling, like I said, deer antler. Velvet, right? And glandulars, pituitary glandulars, because that had growth hormone in it. And I would take all those things and I would drink my protein drinks. And I saw Rocky. So I would put a raw egg in it and put it in the blender and drink it like Rocky and lift my weights. When I got old enough to get into school, I thought, gosh, you know, is there any way I can make a career of this? So in my educational I planned, well, maybe I'll either become a doctor, maybe orthopedics deals with muscles, or get into some other science. And that's when I really started actual education into the field of fitness and health and bodybuilding.
And your transition from bodybuilding to supplement industry, how did that happen?
That happened when I was in school. Although I was in the physiology department, I would take nutrition classes. So I also have a minor in nutrition and loved the nutrition classes. Mm-hmm. And the chair of the department of the nutrition department where I was going to university invited me at one point to teach then a course on dietary supplements for the nutrition department. Yeah. Because the trained dietitians would just kind of cringe at the thought of having to teach about dietary supplements. You have the food pyramid. It's good enough. You don't need supplements. And they saw the dietary supplement industry is kind of antagonistic towards what they were trying to do, which was get people to change their diet. Mm-hmm. So they wouldn't teach the course. I lived in Utah, which is a hotbed for dietary supplement industry, and the university wanted some sort of training for young people who were going to inevitably go to work in that industry. Mm-hmm. So I began to teach about the dietary supplement industry at that time. And it was a survey course, and mostly for PharmD students. So students who were going to be pharmacists, mm-hmm. you know, there where you find pharmacies, there's always dietary supplements around the pharmacy counter. Right. And they're asked constantly about dietary supplements, but their curriculum as a pharmacist does not cover nutrition or dietary supplements at all. Hmm. So it became a required course for the graduate PharmD students. And then I taught that for over a decade. And that's when probably I got good at the science of supplements, I guess.
Sounds like you had to.
Yeah. And after that, through a connection through the university, besides my first, you know, I did a little startup of a bodybuilding company called HSN, Hypertrophy Specific Nutrition.
Oh, uh-huh.
Short-lived, costly, great learning experience. Uh-huh. But then probably my first big job was for Shift Nutrition. And I got that through a connection when I was in university, the Luke Bucci, who was working for Schiff at that time, head of their R&D department, would come speak as a guest speaker. And we became friends, and the time came when he invited me to come work for them. And that's when I, you know, became more familiar with the industry side of it. So, and that was
15 years ago.
Yeah, 2009, 2010.
So now you work with B&D Nutritional Ingredients, and they provide raw materials to supplement manufacturers and then ultimately to end consumers, depending on if you're an end consumer or a brand watching this. So B&D Nutritional, what sets their ingredients apart? How do they decide what ingredients they're going to represent?
Yeah, you're going to have two kinds of suppliers primarily in the supplement industry. You're going to have commodities. Mm-hmm. And these are high volume, low margin, your vitamin and mineral premixes.
So stuff that's been around forever.
And then you're going to have branded ingredients. And these are usually more unique ingredients that have their own clinical data that have been performed on them. And B&D's, really their niche is for branded ingredients. Mm. We do sell some commodities. We've been working with some of our partners, ADM, for many years, over 30 years. But primarily it's branded ingredients, and these are premium ingredients, so they cost more. But they cost more because clinical research has been conducted on them before they're brought to market. Right. And that's where, and we know our brands and customers are mainly selling claims. And to sell that claim, they have to have substantiation for the ingredient. Mm-hmm. So we try to carry substantiated ingredients that help those brands make the kind of claims that are trending and those that they want to make.
And so for consumers, if they're looking at a label, they'll often see these branded ingredients and then they'll know, oh, there's science backing it up that I can go look into.
So. And things have improved with imported ingredients, but traditionally there have been issues with certain foreign imports that have caused people to distrust supplements. And you can know with a branded ingredient that extra scrutiny is taken in their manufacturing and their sourcing, that you needn't worry about the quality and composition of those ingredients if they're branded. That's one thing that gives people a little peace of mind with branded ingredients.
So you and I earlier today were in a really interesting presentation, and we were talking about we didn't talk about pro, but pro is assumed in there, pre, pro, and postbiotics. Can you explain the difference between the three?
Yeah. Whenever we're talking about biotics, we're essentially talking at this point about bacteria. We all have bacteria that live on our skin and in our digestive system. These bacteria are good bacteria for the most part. And if there's any bad ones, we hope they stay in few enough number they don't cause any trouble. The composite or the whole of these bacteria is called our microbiome. And we need these companion bacteria for health. And this is an area of study that's really taken off in the last 10 years or so. And our understanding of it has grown tremendously with a lot of surprises about what role this microbiome plays in our overall health. Some very interesting research is done with what are called sterile mice, meaning they're able to deliver a baby mouse that is completely free of a microbiome. So they have no bacteria on them, in them at all.
Because human babies, the microbiome is populated through the vaginal canal.
Exactly. Exactly. And it starts from there. It's seeded and it grows from there. So with these sterile mice, they're able to get an idea of what role does this microbiome play in the development of the animal. And that's when they began to see that it has cognitive developmental impacts. It has immune impacts. There's an axis between the gut and many other systems in the body that we were completely unaware of before.
The vagus nerve or something else?
Well, yes, the vagus nerve, but also just the central nervous system, seeing that these bacteria produce neurotransmitters, for example, like GABA or serotonin. Yeah. So
not necessarily our body producing them, but the bacteria producing them.
Yeah. So
interesting.
Yeah, most of the body's serotonin is actually in the gut, not in the brain, even though that's what we're talking about. But anyway, so we're living in a very complementary kind of symbiotic relationship with these bacteria. And as might be expected, everybody's microbiome is like a fingerprint, right? So nobody's is the same. Everybody, and there's thousands of species. So everybody has their own ratio of which species and which amount and which are predominant. But lifestyle can have a tremendous impact on that balance of bacteria. Who's present, who's active, who's missing. There's a condition called dysbiosis, right? It's when your microbiome is not in good shape. It's either missing some very important players or it has too many of some bad players. And the most healthy microbiomes are those with the most diversity or the greatest variety of bacteria, so that you have a lot of redundancy in the benefits and the roles that they play. So if you get one strain that begins to go up or down, it doesn't have a tremendous impact on the whole. That's when the notion of a probiotic appeared.
So those are the bacteria themselves, the probiotic.
Yes, a probiotic is a bacteria that is given to an individual that plays or impacts their health. So a probiotic essentially has to produce good effects to be a probiotic.
Gotcha.
If it doesn't, it's just bacteria, right? So traditional probiotic benefits include less inflammation in the digestive tract, okay? A decrease in bad bacteria that are present in the digestive tract. It can also influence mood. It can influence our metabolic rate, including how many calories we're able to extract from our food. And the list kind of goes on, depending on what type of bacteria that you're talking about. We still have a lot to learn about the microbiome. It's just too complex to know everything all at once. And what we're really studying when we study the microbiome is the DNA that is contained in the microbiome, because that DNA produces substances and proteins mm-hmm. that have an impact on us, on our health.
And then anything prebiotic is feeding
yes.
that bacteria.
And to be considered a prebiotic, it has to only feed good bacteria.
Okay.
It can't increase the number of bad bacteria.
Okay.
Now, sugar is not a prebiotic. Why? Because both good and bad bacteria like to eat it.
Oh, fascinating.
Certain fibers, bad bacteria are not able to eat. They can't eat it and they can't grow with it. The most common is probably inulin. That might be the most common prebiotic that somebody would be familiar with. Those only feed the good bacteria. And that way it gives them a leg up on the bad bacteria.
And then postbiotic?
Yep. A postbiotic are all the compounds that a probiotic will produce in the course of just consuming and growing and multiplying. So
it's like the compost.
Yes, it's like the compost. If you have a cow, it's the manure, right?
I was trying to go for a better word, yeah, but okay.
But it has a lot of benefits. It makes the field grow, mm-hmm. right? Well, all these compounds that bacteria produce when they're metabolizing their food are healthy for the individual cells of our digestive tract. And these are primarily short-chain fatty acids, butyric acid, propionic acid, acetic acid. These have a significant impact on the health of the cells that line our digestive tract. They also produce vitamins and minerals. They also produce, as we mentioned earlier, some neurotransmitters and different peptides. And in addition, their very presence in the digestive tract helps our immune system stay awake. Mm. Because these bacteria are not human cells, our immune system takes note when it notices them come into the system, whether it be after you've eaten something before the 3-second rule off the floor, or when you've taken a probiotic, or when you have dirty fingers and you're eating your lunch. Bacteria is introduced into our system all the time. Mm-hmm. And our immune system has to keep track as to who's there, who's coming in, who belongs, and who needs to be kicked mm-hmm. out. So in the process of that, probiotics keep our immune system primed and exercised and ready to go.
And as you can probably imagine, B&D carries many different Indeed. Forms of pre and post. I don't know about pro. We didn't talk about pro today, but.
Yeah. So we sell both pre, pro, and postbiotics. And in an effort, because they all work in somewhat different ways and brands have different requirements as to the stability that they require of mm-hmm. an ingredient. Mm-hmm. Sometimes a probiotic just isn't going to work. Because the production of a food, a bar, or a beverage is just kind of too rough for a probiotic to survive. And others, if you think of a probiotic as a plant that you put in the garden, prebiotic is fertilizer that you put in a garden. Mm-hmm. So rather than just improving the garden by introducing one species of plant, you can improve the whole garden by fertilizing the whole garden. So some people say, well, I don't want just a probiotic. I want to add a prebiotic to it. Others say, well, I can't afford to try to keep the probiotic alive. Is there a way of getting the benefit of a probiotic without having to keep it alive? Well, yes, that's a postbiotic. Mm-hmm. So there are many niches and reasons and marketing reasons and health reasons to be interested in all three.
I did have kind of an off-topic question. There was an ingredient discussed today that's especially good for women. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering, so we were talking really about it showing up in a supplement that you take by mouth, but could it also be formulated into some sort of like topical application, like a cream or something like that?
Yeah, interestingly, well, for women's health, usually we're talking about the vaginal canal, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. And unbeknownst, the probiotics that you take in a capsule end up in the vaginal canal. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So one example is L-reuteri, which mm-hmm. is a probiotic that's been known for some time to improve women's health, vaginal health, by reducing pathogenic bacteria or bacteria that shouldn't be in there. Mm-hmm. Because they're a lactobacillus, they also produce lactate. So it's an acid, so they help control the pH. Mm. the pH of an environment is important to which bacteria can live and which ones can't stand mm-hmm. to be there. So those types of bacteria can be taken by mouth as a capsule for vaginal health because they go in your mouth and out the other end and travel mm-hmm. everywhere, mm-hmm. right? And so they end up in there. Probiotics can also be used as a suppository, like as a topical, mm-hmm. but it's less convenient. There are other benefits to the probiotic also as it travels through the digestive tract. It leaves benefits all the way, acting as a probiotic as well as for vaginal health.
Interesting. So I'm a huge supplement taker. I'm assuming you are as well. How many supplements do you take in a day?
Probably 30.
Wow.
So, but I wouldn't, it's not necessary. I've just gotten myself, because I'm constantly reading research, I'll find something interesting. It's like, hey, I want that benefit. So I'll buy it. And I just start taking it. Right. And some people are not quote pill takers. I don't care. I take a handful of pills and swallow them down. It doesn't really bother me. If anybody asks, I say, take a multi and an omega-3. Call it a day. After that, there are so many different benefits, illegitimate ones. I mean, that was part of, you know, teaching PharmD students. They were very skeptical. Mm-hmm. They were only taught that supplements aren't regulated and they're potentially dangerous and they don't do anything anyway. Mm-hmm. End of story. Next topic.
They are regulated, everyone.
They are absolutely regulated by the Dietary Supplement Health and Education Act. For sure. And they were shocked to find out actual legitimate academic research by the National Institutes of Health trying to discover what are the various health impacts of dietary supplements and different nutrients. It's a whole industry that unfortunately is misrepresented, usually mm-hmm. by the media, mm-hmm. unfortunately by some medical and pharmacy groups, because they're in direct competition for people's attention and dollars. But yeah, I spend my day reading about what various ingredients do. I find something interesting. I go, yeah, I'll try it.
So yeah, I'm constantly.
I try it.
Especially here, because I'm here and I'm exposed
to
that.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, I'm going to take that home and see how I feel about that. But you mentioned something earlier, something called loading phase.
Yeah.
And so this is that idea of certain ingredients need to be in your body long enough so that they build up a quantity to have the effect. Are there certain classes of ingredients that require a loading phase?
Yeah.
That the consumer can know about?
Yeah, your body is in control about how much of what is in it. And it does a very good job of this because it doesn't trust you to decide, right? So you have a whole system in your body that's responsible for your survival. Breathing, eating, drinking, sleeping, and what can get in and what can get out.
Are we talking about the amygdala or what are we talking
yes,
about here?
It's the reptile brain,
okay.
Right?
The reptile brain, back here.
Yep. And it doesn't rely on us to know exactly what we need and in what amounts because we can't consciously always know. We don't mm-hmm. know when we're deficient in something if you don't feel it. So it controls the levels of just about everything that you have in your body, mm-hmm. right? Including water, vitamins, minerals, proteins, carbs, everything. Some compounds, usually these are amino acids or neurotransmitters or metabolites. Think of creatine phosphate, for example, as a metabolite. These levels can increase or decrease depending on the abundance of precursors. So when you take creatine monohydrate, mm-hmm. the muscle cells and other cells of the body will get an increase in the level of creatine monophosphate. That's great because that's the energy shuttle. So your body can recycle ATP if it has access to creatine.
Okay.
Now it puts a cap on it, meaning you can't just take more and more creatine and have more and more creatine in your cells. It doesn't work that way. Mm-hmm. There's a transporter, and when it has enough, locks the door.
And you excrete it out.
And everything else you're taking isn't going to get in. Now, mm-hmm. you're not going to have a decline mm-hmm. in the amount as long as you continue to take it. Mm-hmm. But you're no longer loading. You are now maintaining.
Gotcha.
there are other things in the body, and for example, carnosine. Mm-hmm. Those levels can go up and down based on the availability of beta-alanine. Mm-hmm. And studies have shown that you can increase the level of carnosine in your cells by supplementing beta-alanine. But because the body is managing its levels, it requires a consistent supply that is more than you currently have to get a consistent increase in the levels of the cells. And so that's what we would call a loading supplement. Creatine, you load it. You take it for 30 days at a certain amount. Then you can take a third that much and maintain those levels. Same with beta-alanine. You want more carnosine in your muscles as a buffer of lactic acid and cognitive function. So you load it for 30 days at a certain level. Then you can take less.
To maintain it.
Not all supplements work that way, however, because the body doesn't maintain quantities. For example, you wouldn't load B vitamins, right? They're water soluble. Your body uses what it needs and excretes the rest. That's why you have to continue to take B vitamins all the time or you get a deficiency. Mm. Now, fat soluble, you can store in fat tissue. So if you stop taking fat soluble vitamins, you will have some supply with that's been stored. But it's not active when it's being stored. It's simply put away, unlike creatine or beta-alanine, which can be loaded. Most supplements do not require that they be loaded. However, that doesn't mean that there aren't times when more of that nutrient isn't required. Mm-hmm. The body is very adaptive and it accommodates changes in intake, dietary intake. If you're ill, for example, you may require more glutamine. And so because your body is using glutamine to fuel the immune system.
Oh, okay.
So it's being used up.
Used up. Mm-hmm.
And so you would want more glutamine when you're sick or when your immune system is being compromised or when you're being overworked, right? But again, it's not exactly loading. It's providing more of a conditionally essential nutrient. And glutamine is conditionally essential.
Okay, this is a way more technical question than I thought it was going to be. Okay, yeah. So then let me ask you this. For a consumer, is there a good rule of thumb? Would you say, hey, keep taking the supplement for 4 to 6 weeks before you decide, yes, I am or I'm not feeling a benefit?
That's difficult to say because they aren't always going to feel the benefit.
Okay.
Doesn't mean if they don't feel it, there's no benefit.
Gotcha.
And that's the hard thing about supplements. It's easy to sell something that people feel. Mm-hmm. Caffeine's the easiest thing to sell in the world, right? Because you feel it. Vitamins and minerals you can't feel. Omega-3s you can't feel, but they are absolutely essential to your health. Most supplements, unfortunately, you just will not feel, even if you're deficient. However, the way to know whether you are having adequate intake or not is to simply look at your diet. If your diet is not well balanced and well rounded, but is, I hate to say it, typical.
You seem standard American.
Standard American, you would benefit from supplementation. And the government has even done large studies to determine which nutrients are likely, if not certainly, deficient in the American diet. And there are a number of them, and you can find those out. So just about anyone would benefit from a multivitamin mineral. You won't feel it if you need one. You probably won't feel any different after you start taking one. But those processes that require vitamins and minerals to do the enzymatic reactions, the function of the immune system, cognitive function, in so many subtle ways, in those individual moments you don't notice, but cumulatively you will be better off. Mm-hmm. And we have the data to show, you know, those who take a multi, there's ways to measure after, like you say, a year's time or longer, seem to have less episodes of certain kinds of problems. But again, you can't give somebody a multi and they say, oh, an hour later, boy, I feel so much better. Thank you. Our bodies just don't work that way.
Right. Right. So I was, for background for anyone listening, I was asking this question because I am in year 9 of perimenopause, and I've absolutely seen a huge benefit with the supplements that I take for that. But it did take 4 to 6 weeks mm-hmm. for me to stop waking up in the middle of the night,
right?
Stop having those hot flashes. So I was wondering if there was kind of a rule of thumb.
Not a rule of thumb, but that is a real thing. And that has to do with, again, our adaptive tendency of our body. Acute things, meaning you take something once or you're exposed right. to something once, the body will accommodate that exposure without making any changes to things.
Oh, interesting.
Right?
Okay. Uh-huh.
Because change is costly. It costs energy, right? But if there appears to be a consistent change in the environment, the body will then change and adapt to the new presence or absence of something.
Oh, interesting.
And that can take time. Now, from a dietary perspective, usually metabolically, like to switch from, let's say, a high-carb diet to a low-carb diet, 3 weeks. So your body will absolutely function differently if you reduce the availability of carbohydrates, but that will take like 3 weeks for enzymes to change, for genetic expression to change, to produce those additional enzymes. So you can't just go, oh, I did low carb for a few days and I felt terrible. It's like, well, yeah, I bet you did.
Right. That was a big change. You shocked your body there.
And vitamins too. There will be adaptive things that happen if you are deficient in a vitamin. Your body's trying to hang on to it. And it's not using it if it doesn't have to. It's kind of an oversimplification, but no, you can see differences after months of supplementation that you wouldn't see immediately within a few days.
Okay.
So that is a real thing.
Okay. 3 fun questions to head out of this interview. Number 1, if you were a supplement, what would you be?
Protein powder.
I could have guessed. Flavored or unflavored?
Unflavored.
Unflavored.
Versatile.
Just the base protein.
Goes with anything.
Okay. This might, if you were on a deserted island, which supplement would you take with you?
Multi.
And what supplement do you not see out in the market that you fantasize about?
There's more than one.
One. You have to pick one.
I would say it would have to be metabolites of omega-3s. So lipid moderators. Your body takes an omega-3 and it will make metabolites of it that actively shut off inflammation.
Mm.
And that's doable, but nobody's doing it.
Fascinating. Oh my gosh. Bryan, we'll have to have you back. It's been such a pleasure to have you here. Thank you for joining us.
It's such a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much.